The scripture reading for this morning is found in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1, and I shall read verses 18 through 25. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1, starting with verse 18. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "The virgin shall be with child, and will give birth to a son, and they'll call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. Christmas is a season that's filled with surprises. Gifts tightly wrapped in multicolored paper are placed beneath the Christmas tree, and you don't know what's in them until you open them. At Christmas time, it's not unusual for us to receive surprise gifts, like the tie that you will never wear because it doesn't match the color of your suits, or the so-called fruitcake made in China with all artificial ingredients that even your dog would refuse to eat. Well, the angel Gabriel one day surprised the Virgin Mary when he announced to her that God had chosen her to bear his son. We are surprised that God chose a humble peasant girl to be the vehicle of bringing his son into this world. We're surprised that God did not choose a celebrity or a princess to be the mother of his son, but he chose a humble peasant girl who was still a teenager. Mary was surprised when the angel informed her that her pregnancy would be the result of some divine action. We can see her surprise in her response when she said, "How can this be, for I am still a virgin?" We are surprised that the Virgin Mary consented to accept God's plan for her, knowing full well the enormity of the shame and disgrace she would be exposed to for being an unwed mother. Joseph was surprised when Mary, his fiancée, finally broke her secret to him. He found her story to be incredible. He found it hard to believe the explanation that she gave to him. He couldn't imagine how such a pregnancy could happen without the participation of a male. He felt like his whole world had collapsed because he loved Mary and he was dreaming and planning to start a new family with her. he realized that he had two options. One was to expose her publicly, and in that case, she would be stoned to death, because that was the penalty which the law of Moses prescribed for adultery. Or his second option was to break the engagement and walk away silently without making Mary a public spectacle. As Joseph was weighing his options, he was surprised by an angel who appeared to him in a dream and assured him that his fiancée Mary was pure and that the child she was bearing was conceived by the Holy Spirit. And the angel instructed Joseph to call Mary's child Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. Mary and Joseph, who had established a humble home in Nazareth, were greatly surprised when the Roman Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census be taken throughout his empire for the purpose of levying new taxes on his subjects. According to Caesar's decree, all people were obligated to return to their ancestral towns to be registered there. Mary and Joseph had no plans of traveling to Bethlehem because they were from the lineage of King David and they had to go to the city of David, which was Bethlehem. The distance from Nazareth to Bethlehem is roughly 90 miles, and Mary was in the ninth month of her pregnancy. Making that long journey over rugged, hilly terrain was very perilous. But they had no option. They had to obey Caesar's command. Had they remained in Nazareth, and if Jesus were born there, he wouldn't have fulfilled a biblical prophecy, an important biblical prophecy found in Micah chapter 5, verse 2, that says, the ruler of Israel, the Messiah, will come out of the city of Bethlehem, out of the city of David. The first Christmas brought a great surprise to the humble shepherds who were watching their flocks in the fields that surrounded the little town of Bethlehem. They probably have lit a fire not only to warm up themselves but also to discourage wolves from approaching their flocks. They were engaged in their daily routine when all of a sudden a marvelous light illuminated the dark sky, and an angelic choir appeared, announcing to them the birth of a Savior. We are surprised that God chose the shepherds to be the first visitors to the manger. We're surprised that the first news of Jesus' birth was broken to those shepherds. When we dig through the historical annals, we find that at one time the profession of the shepherds was a respected trade. You remember the prophet Moses was a shepherd at one time. King David started his life as a shepherd, but during the first century AD, during the time of Jesus' birth, shepherds had acquired a bad reputation. They, people thought that they were liars and thieves. Of course, these charges cannot be substantiated, but this was the perception people had of all shepherds. When shepherds passed through a village or a city street, people locked their doors for safety. And we know that the Jewish law at the time prohibited shepherds from giving any testimony or eyewitness account in any courtroom throughout the land of Israel. And the Talmud, which is a Jewish holy book, the second holy book for the Jews, next to the Bible, says, don't render any assistance to the Gentiles and to the shepherds. So the shepherds were classified with the Gentiles. The Jews considered the shepherds to be unclean because of their profession. They could not keep the Sabbath holy. They had to work 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, watching the sheep, guiding them from pasture to pasture was a full-time job. And so they were ostracized from society. They were at the lowest rung of the social ladder. They were despised and rejected. They were completely disenfranchised. The first Christmas surprised the learned Magi, who saw a mysterious star in the east, and they understood its significance because it foretold the birth of a divine king. And they decided to embark on a long journey that covered over 1,000 miles. They took precious, costly presents with them. I'm sure that when they left their hometown, people asked them where they were going, especially when they saw them loading their camels with food and those precious gifts. And the Magi, and people were surprised when the Magi said they didn't know where the star would lead them. They started the journey without knowing where the star would take them to. We're surprised that the Magi, who were Gentiles, recognized the divinity of Jesus Christ through the gifts that they offered. The first gift the Magi gave Jesus was gold. And this way they acknowledged him as a king. Because in those days, if a person wanted to honor a king by giving a present, that present had to be made of gold. And when the Magi gave Jesus the second gift, which was frankincense, frankincense was used by the priests. In their censers, they added it to coal in their censers so that the smoke coming out of the censers would be sweet smelling. So by giving Jesus frankincense, they recognized him as a priest. They recognized Jesus' priesthood. And then they gave him myrrh, which was used as an ingredient in an ointment to treat all types of skin diseases. So by giving him this present, they acknowledged him as a physician. So Jesus was a king and priest at the same time, and of course he was the world's greatest physician. We're surprised that these Gentiles, when they saw the baby Jesus, they recognized him as a divine king, although he was not born in a palace, he didn't wear a golden crown on his head, and he did not hold a golden scepter in his hand. Yet these Gentile Magi recognized him as king, as a divine king. The first Christmas surprised King Herod, who ruled over Judea. By the time Jesus was born, King Herod was a 70-year-old man. But he had not lost his cunning and his cruelty. So when the Magi arrived in Jerusalem inquiring about the newborn king of the Jews, the Bible says King Herod and all Jerusalem with him were disturbed. King Herod was disturbed because he didn't want to have any rivals. He wanted to remain the only king of the Jews. Whenever he suspected that some people were hatching a plot against him, he had them killed. He eliminated them mercilessly. So this was a king who retained his throne and authority through violence and bloodshed. He had no respect for human life. And the Bible, we can understand why he was disturbed. Because he didn't want to have a rival. But why all Jerusalem, all the people of Jerusalem were disturbed with him? Well, the people of Jerusalem knew King Herod because he had ruled over them for 40 years. They were well acquainted with his character. And they were afraid, they were disturbed, and they were afraid because they didn't know what this old, crazy man would do. We actually are not surprised when King Herod ordered his soldiers to go through Bethlehem and slaughter all the male children who were 2 years old and under. Our country was shocked and surprised when they heard about a young gunman who went to an elementary school in the town of Newtown and mercilessly slaughtered 20 innocent children aged 6 and 7 and their teachers. He killed 7 of their children, of their teachers. The whole nation was shocked because such a heinous crime was committed during the Christmas season. But this wasn't the time such a crime was committed. King Herod had committed such a heinous crime more than 2,000 years ago. People who don't know God, who don't have Jesus living in their hearts, are capable of committing cruel crimes. The first Christmas brought a great surprise to the Jewish theologians and religious scholars. Because when Herod heard that a newborn king of the Jews had been born, he called the theologians to his court and he wanted to know where such a prediction was recorded, and he wanted to know in which town the newborn king of the Jews was located. And those theologians, without any hesitation, and without much thinking, they instantly answered, said, in Bethlehem of Judea. Because that's what the prophetic oracles said, that out of Bethlehem would come he who would be ruler over Israel. Those theologians knew the Bible well. They could cite chapter and verse. They answered King Herod's question instantly. But they did not show any interest in going to Bethlehem and and pay a visit to the newborn king of the Jews. They were completely disinterested. They had a religion, but they didn't have faith. They knew the Bible, but they did not believe in its prophecies. That's why they missed out. They lost their opportunity, their chance of being saved. The first Christmas brought a big surprise to the majority of the Jews who lived then, because the long-awaited king did not come the way they anticipated he would come. The Jews thought that the Messiah would be a military man who would drive the Romans out of their country and restore their independence and the kingship of David. They never thought that the Messiah would come as a helpless baby, born in a smelly stable and laid in a manger. So we're surprised that Jesus was born in such humble surroundings. John Howard Griffin was a white American who believed that no one could understand the plight of African Americans in the Deep South. Unless they went through what they experienced. So he stained his body with dark paint and went to the Deep South to experience the discrimination, the prejudice to which African Americans and people of color were exposed on a daily basis. And then he wrote a book. In 1959, he published his book entitled Black Like Me. And he says he could experience the plight of African Americans in the Deep South back then only by becoming like one of them. That's why Jesus left the glories of heaven and came in a human body and performed the role of a servant in order to know our plight, to experience our plight, to share our sufferings, our trials, and to be able to save us from sin and its consequences. Isaiah chapter 53 verse 3 says, he became acquainted with our grief. Yes, we have a Savior who sympathizes with us, because like us, he was tempted in every point, but he never sinned. That's what the author of the Epistle to the Hebrews says. Jesus was tested, was tempted, like us, in every point, but he never sinned. Therefore, he is able not only to sympathize with us, but to help us when we face our trials. I'm sure that you're acquainted with Dr. Seuss. You probably bought his books for your children. Dr. Seuss was an American author who wrote books only for children. He published 42 books that are now translated into 34 languages. In one of his books is entitled How the Grinch Stole Christmas. He writes about an imaginary city called Whoville, which was located in a valley. And he describes a mean-spirited man called the Grinch, who lived in a cave overlooking the valley where the city of Whoville was located. And this mean-spirited man hated Christmas and wanted to put an end to all Christmas celebrations. So one night before Christmas, he sneaked into the town of Whoville And he stole all the presents that were underneath the Christmas trees in all the homes. And he destroyed all the Christmas lights that decorated the city streets. And he also stole all the Christmas foods and the cookies that people had prepared. And he thought that without Christmas presents and without Christmas decorations and without Christmas cookies, the people of Uvil would not be able to celebrate Christmas. But to his great surprise, all the people who lived in that city celebrated Christmas, even though they had no presents to exchange. See, Christmas, dear friends, is not just a day to be observed. Christmas is not just an event to be observed and hastily forgotten. Christmas is the spirit of unselfish love that should permeate our lives throughout our existence on this earth.